Standing if you're able, may the Lord add his blessing to the hearing of his word. Today's Bible verse is from 1 John chapter 4, verses 18 through 21, and I'll be reading from the New International Version. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this commandment: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. The word of God for the people of God. Please be seated.
Again, I'm Chris Bryant, senior pastor here. Thank you so much for joining us in person. It's great attendance today. I'm so thankful to see you here, as this is, in many ways, the unofficial end of non-school summer. And some of our families are away, but I feel good about our attendance. Thank you so much for being here. If you're watching online, thank you so much. Hopefully some of those vacationer families are tuning in anyway. I know Miss Reed, who's a faithful member here in our traditional service, recovering from surgery, is watching this morning. Saw her dial in, and the folks here, I believe, got her instructions right. The flowers look good, so she made sure to give good direction there for our flowers again, and it's beautiful. Also want to say hello to Dr. and Claudia Anderson from Ohio, who watches at least occasionally, if not regularly. And so been meaning to mention folks that are watching online, because we are all part of this beloved community. Whether we can worship in person, or whether we are deterred from doing so, or whether it's a choice, or whether we're just far away, may we connect as beloved community. It's been an interesting summer, friends. Short one for me. I've had a little bit going on. So much has happened in my life, and here we stand on the precipice of another school year starting shortly, and I'm grateful. I'm grateful for this church. I'm grateful for the challenge of the Songs of Summer theme. It's been interesting. It's been creative, at least for me. I think it might have been for you too, but certainly to try to match these songs that so many of us know, and surely there's been at least one week where you've connected with one of the songs that we've done. But yet pair that with this idea, this vision for beloved community that comes out of the gospel according to John, and very specifically 1 John, which is what we've been looking at, and of course 2 and 3 John too, which are very, very brief epistles. Today we continue with a song that actually references Jesus. The only one of our series that actually references Jesus Christ. And with it, our passage of Scripture is perhaps the most well-known of all of 1 John. Indeed, if you've ever had to do memory verses as a child, or maybe you're like me as an adult, and you still like to memorize Scripture and contemplate on it, probably one of the verses of our passage today is one that you've learned from 1 John. 1 John 4:19, we love because he first loved us. Now, that was our second verse, but it was one of the first ones I tried to teach my children. I don't know if I did a very good job, but I remember as a young father trying to teach that to my first son, and with every consecutive son as they were little. That was one of our memory verses. It seemed like something they could remember, and it was important that they remember. We love, it's important for our faith. We love because he first, God, that is God in Christ, first loved us. Now, back up, verse 18. There is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear. Fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Oftentimes, we just remember that first part of that verse, there's no fear in love. Or perhaps we remember, perfect love casts out fear. Verse 20, whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar, for whoever does not love their brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they haven't seen. And he has given us this command, anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. Any of these verses are worthy of memorization and contemplation. It appears as our author has in his creative redundancy, and it has been redundant, friends. How many ways can you talk about loving God as loving one's brother and sister? Well, according to 1 John, apparently an awful lot, even for five short chapters. Anyway, it appears that our author in his creative redundancy has contributed to some of the best known, if not always or even rarely practiced, verses in the New Testament. You see, 1 John is working on this back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Circular, building up. How about right belief in Christ? And that is very specifically that Christ wasn't just some sort of spiritual event, but a real person in Jesus of Nazareth. Real flesh and blood, who did real flesh and blood acts of love, who suffered and died physically. That it was important to believe that, 1 John tells us. And in believing that, that links up. It automatically connects us with a faith that therefore leads for our loving physically, our outward physical demonstration, examples of love towards others. Put simply, our scripture today makes four claims. Perfection, one who has yet to be perfected in love. The meaning, being perfected in love means that God has brought God's intended goal to our life. To Christian love. The intended goal being that his love for us has now graduated and become our love for others. His agape love now coming fully through us, loving others. Starting in the household of faith and presumably to all others. Secondly, the point is, loving people isn't easier than loving God. It's not a 1-2-step process. But rather, love for God provides a kind of test that verifies our love for God. Third, the experience of God that you and I might claim cannot be individual, cannot be purely individual, that is, but has to incorporate some sense of community. Otherwise, how can we ever validate such love, such experience? For the love of this God is understood, experienced in our love for one another. Fourth, anything that contradicts such a self-giving love as demonstrated by Christ has to be ruled out. Has to be ruled out by our people, by us as people of God, as children of God. Even those actions that at times we might profess to be done out of love, if they are in fact actually expressing our desire to dominate and control, they are not indeed actually loving. So that was a whole bunch of theology that I hope to make more plain in what I say next. And we begin with this great song by a group called U2, an Irish rock group, and this particular song, which is considered a pop song, known by its most common name, In the Name of Love. That phrase, In the Name of Love, is repeated a dozen times. It's an incredibly simple song, actually. We'll say more about that here in just a moment. And as we connect it with some of the other of our scripture and our meaning today. But the original title is Pride. That's the original title. And still today, if you look it up, you can find it under Pride. And normally it's around a parentheses. But it was originally titled Pride because as it was released in 1984 in their Unforgettable Fire album, it was originally written as a response to the arms race. And what the band felt was an unhealthy pride, specifically at that time by President Ronald Reagan in America's military force. However, during the writing process, a number of lyrics changed, and it started to move away from that negative kind of satire or commentary and move more towards what the song now means, more of a positive witness towards people that the band believed changed the world for good and did it in a very specific, nonviolent way. Specifically, Jesus Christ and Martin Luther King Jr. And so the contrast in the song moved away from President Reagan and perhaps some other person, and instead became the contrast between Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr., and the difference between nonviolent versus violent protesting. Here are the lyrics. And again, these are so simple, I can read you all of them. One man come in the name of love. One man he come and go. One man comes he to justify. One man to overthrow. In the name of love, what more in the name of love? In the name of love, what more in the name of love? One man come on a barbed wire fence. One man he resist. One man washed on an empty beach. One man betrayed with a kiss. That's Jesus, right? Obviously. Then again, the repetition of in the name of love, what more in the name of love? And then early morning, which is a mistake. I'll talk about that here in a minute. Early morning, April 4, a shot rings out in the Memphis sky. What's that about? That's the assassination of Martin Luther King Jr. That's right. Free at last, they took your life. They could not take your pride. There's the name of the song. And then it repeats four times in a row, in the name of love, in the name of love. Now, the mistake, the small mistake in the song is, of course, that Martin Luther King Jr. was shot in the evening. It was a little bit after 6 o'clock. And Bono, the lead singer, has often admitted that mistake in the song. And normally when he sings a song, he changes the lyrics. He actually says, in the evening, April 4, is what he sings now. Originally, Pride received mixed critical reviews at the time, but became a major commercial success. It's in the running for the most sung U2 song. They've sung it at almost every performance they've done since the song was released. In 2009, the count was like 770 times. The song ranked 388 on Rolling Stone's list of the 500 greatest songs of all time, and it's included in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, 500 songs that shaped rock and roll's list. Some other interesting facts about the song, because every week I've got feedback that you appreciate this. The melody and the chords for this song were improvised on a sound check. They were doing a completely different concert. And like, but you know, how musicians, they just kind of, you know, sometimes if you're not a real musical person, but you appreciate it, maybe, you know, you've been here to our praise band, or maybe you've stumbled into the church sometime, or Taylor's on one of any number of instruments, and you just plop down and listen, because well, they were doing that. They were just kind of playing around. And they kind of hit this harmony. And in fact, as they hit the harmony and they kind of got into this rhythm, it started sounding like a new song. And somebody made a mistake and they liked it. And that sent them in a whole other different direction. And they all changed and went the direction of the mistake, which, as not a quiet musician myself, I can't do a better job of describing what happened. But I thought it was pretty interesting that really the song came about, or at least the musical part of the song, came by an improvisation, and a mistake. In subsequent years, Bono, again the lead singer, has expressed his dissatisfaction with the lyrics, which he describes as being left as simple sketches. He says that he was swayed by the band's guitarists and the band's producers to just leave it the way it is, just more open-ended, almost impressionistic, because that would give the song more added forcefulness. However, he says, gosh, to him now it sounds like just a load of vowel sounds ganging up on a great man, Martin Luther King Jr. Part of this song was used on the 200th episode of The Simpsons. On that show, U2 appear as themselves, the fictional show, it's a cartoon show, and U2 shows up as themselves, and they do the song in the fictional town of Springfield, or you hear part of them as they're doing a concert there. More recently, Dierks Bentley recorded this song for his 2010 Bluegrass album, Up on the Ridge. He was nominated for a Grammy for Best Country Collaboration with the vocals to that song. Then just this year, 2021, at the Country Music Awards, he performed it. He performed this particular song with other country stars. One more story. I thought this was really great. When the band first released the song, they started touring in the U.S. in Tempe, Arizona. In Arizona, at the time, the governor was opposed to Martin Luther King Day being made into a federal U.S. federal holiday. By the time the band headed back to Tempe to close out the tour, They started there, and then they were going to end the tour there. They were receiving death threats for supporting the proposed holiday. Things took a serious turn before their gig at Sun Devil Stadium when someone claimed he would shoot Bono, again the lead singer, shoot him on stage if he sang In the Name of Love, which was the King, Martin Luther King Jr. inspired song. Bono says it was quite serious. The FBI said this guy, they believe he has a ticket, they believe he's armed. They're not sure where he is. And so the band talked about it. You know, they were unnerved. What do we do? In the end, they said, we're going to sing anyway. We're going to do it anyway. And so it came to the point in the show where they were doing the song, and Bono says, he said he recalls, well, maybe he's here. Maybe he's in the rafters. Maybe he's on the roof. Maybe, I don't know, maybe this is it for me. And so he says, I just closed my eyes and kept singing. And he says, he got to the part of the song where the lyrics are, a shot rings out in the Memphis sky, right? And he just prepared himself that he might be shot in that moment. But then nothing happens, and he keeps singing, and then back to that chorus, in the name of love. And he opens his eyes, and when he does, the bass guitarist for the band, without him knowing it, had stepped in front of him. How amazing is that? It's a really neat story, and I think it takes us back right to our scripture, doesn't it? Loving other people. Self-giving love. Self-sacrificial love. That's fundamental for the Christian faith. As our faith is revealed by God in Jesus Christ, who is self-giving and self-sacrificing. The song itself, of course, highlights the civil rights movement, specifically MLK's leadership and nonviolent method, which embodies this scripture we read today in very practical ways. You might even recall that MLK used this phrase, beloved community. And it was also used by the late Georgia Congressman John Lewis. John Meacham writes about both of them in this particular phrase. John Meacham writes, John Lewis never gave up on what he and King thought of as the beloved community, which is not the more perfect union of the American founders. The beloved community was something different, something wholly perfect. It was, as Lewis said, quote, nothing less than the Christian concept of the kingdom of God on earth, end quote. That movement is inexorable, as irresistible as the flow of the river toward the sea. And John Lewis adds, and in that community, Jesus has made love the mark of sovereignty. First John pushes back on a faith that is only principle or is principle only. First John pushes back on a Christian faith lived out in isolation, teachings that would be admired but not put into practice, doctrines merely to be agreed with rather than made practical. First John and the beloved community firmly asserts even when we cannot that we cannot be spiritual in any sense of the merely idealized or mystical faith. But love in God and Christ is about loving real people in real ways. It has to be practical as God's own Son becoming a human being, showing us how to live, dying the death we die, and living again, proving to us that love is not only the better way, it is the only way. And that way is not the way of just words or ideas, but practical action. And whatever that looks like in our own time, in our own lives, in our own moment of history, that's beloved community. MLK Jr. was quoted as saying that any religion that professes to be concerned about the souls of men and is not concerned about the slums that damn them or the economic conditions that strangle them and the social conditions that cripple them is a spiritually moribund religion awaiting burial. He further says, it is Jesus of Nazareth. This is MLK again, MLK Jr. It was Jesus of Nazareth that stirred the Negroes to protest with the creative weapon of love. In sum, Christ furnishes the spirit and motivation, while Gandhi furnished the method, that is, the specific forms of nonviolent practices, protests. It was not enough, these young black men and women were taught, along with them a few white friends. It was not enough, they were taught, to merely protest and endure a beating. It was not enough to resist the urge to strike back. That urge can't be there, they were taught. You have to do more than not just not hit back. You have to have no desire to hit back. You have to love the person hitting you. This, as detergent may have been poured upon their heads as they wait to be served at a counter where they were not welcomed, or ketchup put on their shirts, pushed off their chairs, heads slammed into countertops. John Lewis said that one time he and two others were once locked in a restaurant by themselves when an insecticide was released. It was one of the days that he thought he was going to die, and would have if a passerby hadn't noticed the smoke of fumigation and thought it was a fire and came to help. Another quote from MLK Jr. "We will wear you down by our capacity to suffer. Do to us what you will, and we will still love you. We will meet your physical force with soul force. You may bomb our homes and spit on our children, and we will still love you." Even when fire hoses were turned upon them with pressure that would remove bark from a tree, even when dogs were released, even when people turned up missing and ultimately had been lynched or raped or murdered, there is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loves us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command: anyone who loves God must love their brother and sister. When we think of civil rights, most of us, or maybe I should just speak for me, it's easy for me to think about the March on Washington, or the Lincoln Memorial, or MLK's famous I Have a Dream speech, or maybe you think of President Kennedy or LBJ and the Civil Rights Bill of 65. But when we really should think about, I think, those young African Americans and a few of their white friends all over the South who marched into the fires of hate and history that made the movement come to pass, enduring brutality as they integrated peacefully the segregated lunch counters and bus stations of Nashville and Montgomery and Jackson and Birmingham. Before his own assassination in 68, Robert Kennedy said to then the young John Lewis, who had at that point been arrested 27 times at age 25 and had endured a number of beatings, Robert Kennedy says this to him: "John, the young people," meaning the young people of the nonviolent protest movement, "the young people have educated me. You have changed me. Now I understand." Beloved community, beloved, not hateful, beloved, not violent, beloved, not uncaring, but kind. Community, not separated, not polarized, not locked and struggled. No, an all-inclusive, all-welcoming, everyone belongs, simple justice community where every human being can be the kingdom of God. And he has given us his command: anyone who loves God must love their brother and sister. It's not a second point, it's the same message. Salvation actually received is loving relationships conceived. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. It's very difficult to test whether or not we love God, but it's pretty easy to see whether or not we love others. Our love for others, or its lack of it, demonstrates our love or the lack of love we have for God. Perhaps the God we love or say we love isn't the God revealed in Jesus if we're having so much trouble loving others, for God is love. Indeed, we love because he first loved us. When it gets difficult, we have to remember why. We love because he first loved us. And there is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear. Fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Oh, friends, healthy fear is a good thing, but that's not what this is talking about. Healthy fear, you know, the fear that I might have when one of the Ringgold finest or one of our deputies of the law around the county pulls up behind me, I tend to just drive better. That sort of fear brings the best out of me. It's not the fear of what might happen if I don't wear my safety belt, nor is it the fear of what might happen if I don't wear an oven mitt when I go to get something hot out of the oven. I mean, it's described that way sometimes. I just call that wisdom, common sense. The fear that is being talked about in 1 John is not this healthy kind of fear, not something that could be understood as wisdom or something that would make me better, bring out the best in me. Rather, it's a fear that comes out of our uncertainty in our place and time, uncertainty about who we are, uncertainty about our being loved, uncertainty that we will be cared for and provided for. It is a fear that comes from the broken part of ourselves, something the Bible calls our sinful nature. It is the kind of fear that is destructive in our lives, where we fear the wrong kinds of things. It makes us fear other people just because they're different. People who look different, act different, talk different, maybe worship a different God, believe in different things. We should not fear them. This kind of fear means we fear specific unknowns, and we especially fear the unknown generally. We fear things being taken away from us. And we can even be taught or led to believe that if we don't blame or hate someone else, if we don't in fact fear them, somehow things will get worse for everyone. And that kind of fear keeps us from being perfected in the love of God. Fear keeps us from sharing God's love with others. Fear keeps us isolated and alone. Fear turns our spirituality from beloved community to siloed self-talk faith. Fear makes us worry about whether or not we have enough, choking out any opportunity we might ask ourselves, where can I be more generous? Fear makes us angry about the things we feel cheated by. It makes us angry about other things that otherwise wouldn't make us angry. And that fear can lead to hate. There's a great scene in the movie Remember the Titans, which talks about integration of the schools and in a particular place there in Virginia, and the football team and the two leaders of the team near the end of the movie. One of them has been hurt and is in the hospital, and he's white, and the other is an African American, and they come together at the end, and he's almost not led into the hospital, but ultimately he's allowed because this white kid who's been hurt looks up and says to the nurse, "What is wrong with you? Can't you see the family resemblance? He's my brother." And then right after that scene, or right in the midst of that scene, there's a wonderful confession where that young man says, "This whole time I was afraid of you, Julian. I was afraid of you. The whole time I was just hating my brother." Friends, with the sermon today, there are no three steps to improving your spiritual life. In today's sermon, there is no commendation to pray more, even how to pray, no advice for other spiritual disciplines. There is no word today on how your life might be better specifically or stronger because of faith or a stronger faith, that is. No, today there's just this scripture and the question, what are you going to do with it? Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. Whoever does not love their brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command, anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. Let's pray. Lord, we've prayed almost every single week about this simple message of all the things that we really work on to try to get right about our faith and this life and what you would expect of us and intend for us to be and to do. Again, this week, we have heard the powerful word. Of all the things we try to get right, there's one thing we cannot get wrong. Help us to not get love wrong. Help us to get better and better at loving each other. And together, love the world that you love. For the sake of every soul. For your glory. Lord, thank you for the inspiration of Martin Luther King Jr. and all those. It's sometimes, Lord, we think about him, but as I said in the message, think about all those young people that experienced what they did and how they were living out faith in you, faith in love, real, real love, and how they had to push themselves and really get serious, not just to not respond back with violence, but even love, learn somehow to love those who might oppress them. What a witness there is for at least me, maybe for everybody else too. So Lord, help us today. Help us to receive you, Jesus, even more than we have before. The loving witness in your sacrifice and how that love needs to get in us and grow in us and change us in such a way that we begin to sacrifice, we would begin to live in that self-sacrificing love for all others, period. Because we know you and have been growing in your perfection, towards perfection.